All right, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome back to Legal Studies 160, Punishment, Culture, and Society. This is class four. Speaking of which, if you look on your syllabus, you'll have noted that it lists each class just with a number rather than a date. That's essentially there to protect me in case I fall behind, but my great intent is not to fall behind. So you should operate on the assumption that we will complete one of these numbered units each lecture. If I'm running behind, as I was the first lecture, for instance, I'll endeavor to catch up the next one. So the safe rule of thumb is note which class we're on when the class ends that day, and make sure you've read the next class before the next lecture, and you'll be in good shape. Now, I'm going to tweak this slightly I want to announce it now, and then I'll send out a new syllabus. This is not relevant, obviously, to those of you on podcasting the course exclusively because you won't be taking the midterm, but those of you that will be taking the midterm, it's going to take place on March 1st. And to make that happen, what's currently topic 14, the new death penalty, life without parole, is going to happen after your midterm. So don't worry about taking that note down, and I'll put it in the syllabus. The good news for that is that's one less class worth of stuff that you'll need to know for the midterm. The bad news is it's one more class you'll need to know for the final. But as Beccaria would note, those things that are closer to us in time are more intimidating. So maybe that is a break. The other thing, apropos my announcement last night about the Bolt negotiations course, if you have any interest in that, this is absolutely the last day. Please do email on the email address that was on there. The email address that I put in the announcement as well is the key. So if you're thinking about it, get that in sometime this evening if you want to be considered. All right, so I want to move on today, but let me ask you, there's some questions or follow-up thoughts about the material on retribution and the psychology of retribution. It's all perfectly clear. Good. Okay, so today we're moving on to talk about two of the other sort of classic penal rationales. And again, if you think about our first week together, we were exploring what you might think of as California's penal excesses, the fact that we've put so many people in prison over the last few decades, even more than we can humanely incarcerate. And so in the background of this week's inquiries has been a sort of question: how come we punish so much? Or what can we learn about why we punish so much from thinking about the motivations that lead people to punish, right? We're gonna see that there's lots of other things that could drive punishment, because there's lots of things in punishment other than people's motivations. There's institutions, there are social geographies in which law is being enforced, there's law itself, etc. Nonetheless, we might think that changes in penal patterns over time, the increasing punishment we saw in California from the time I was an undergraduate until the present, when we essentially quintupled the number of people in prison. Can we gain any insight from thinking about the motivations for punishment as to why that might happen? So yesterday, or I should say Tuesday, we were talking about retribution and the social psychology of retribution. And I think two insights at least occur to me that I want to highlight for you to think about as we go forward, whether they're helpful. One point, I think, and it came out when we talked about the Three Strikes Initiative, which we're going to talk a bit more about Three Strikes today as an example of penal excess, is the degree to which if punishment is motivated by moral outrage, that moral outrage, as we saw, isn't necessarily limited to feelings about crime. It can also be based on other feelings about society that suggest to the observer that their moral values are being undermined or endangered. That can include their perception that the family is somehow crumbling, if they think that that's an important institution, as many of us do. That can include, and that seemed to figure powerfully in some of the data collected by Tom Tyler and Robert Beckman, anxiety about immigration, essentially anxiety about diversity in society. If our society is becoming too diverse, does that mean that we have lost our moral consensus? And the argument that Tyler and Beckman suggest is that one of the reasons people supported Three Strikes was not so much they were outraged about crime, as they were outraged, or they had a sense of moral anxiety or outrage about this loss of unity in society, and found in the occasion of this very terrible crime, the kidnapping and murder of Polly Klaus, etc., a proper vehicle for channeling this moral anxiety, even though it wasn't per se about crime. So that's one way to think about why it is that we might see an increase in punishment due to this kind of moral outrage factor in retribution. Another and related, or another point about retribution is that it's possible that our moral values change, so that there are things that we didn't feel outraged about in the past become outrageous to us. A good example of that is hate crimes, right? So racist behavior that was once not only officially tolerated, but sort of supported by this culture, then becomes problematic, and eventually can become criminal. And in some, we have a very strong First Amendment, which protecting speech, which tends to be a constraint on the ability of the criminal law to punish people. If you go to Europe, denying the Holocaust, France just enacted a law suggesting that denying the genocide against the Armenians at the time of World War I, to deny that would become a crime in France if it's signed into law by President Sarkozy. So we can see that people's values might change to make them want to punish more things that they used to ignore before. One good example of that certainly happens during our time period is drunk driving. Back when I was an undergraduate here, I would say there was a much looser attitude culturally toward the seriousness of driving while intoxicated. Yes, it was bad, but it was kind of something of a joke, and it certainly wasn't punished very severely, and now we have much more tough laws on drunk driving, and you can say that those reflect a greater sense of moral outrage at drunk driving that's no longer winked at as a kind of eccentricity or bon vivant sort of lifestyle, but in fact a morally culpable crime. However, I think if you push on that, it's hard to understand how that would account for the scale of the growth of punishment in California. So we do have people in prison today for drunk driving that might not have been there before, or more typically in jail, but not that many of them. Certainly our treatment of crimes that have always been crimes, like burglary, like robbery, like murder, is much more severe. And there's no evidence that we've somehow changed our moral values about those things. Those things have always outraged our moral values. So let me for today suggest that another possible explanation for this relationship between penal rationales or motivations and penal excess is that in addition to our moral outrage, even if the goal of preventing crime isn't the primary motivation for individuals, it may become an add-on motivation. And that's especially true when we think of the fact that punishment isn't directly in the hands of the people, but instead emanates through political institutions that have an incentive in a sense to sell you punishment for more than it might be worth. That is to build up what punishment can do for you. And that's why it's to explore that theme, I think, that I want to look a little bit more closely at the sort of two leading utilitarian justifications for punishment. Now, deterrence and incapacitation, I'm going to define those and talk about them in a moment. You might be saying, well, what about rehabilitation? Yesterday, or Tuesday, when I put up the different penal rationales on the board, I included rehabilitation. And the idea that we should reform people, typically by imprisoning them, has certainly been a very important theme of understanding punishment, at least since the end of the 18th century. And certainly some of the reformers particularly grabbed onto that. But I think what you'll find is that rehabilitation is rarely a motive for increasing the number of people under punishment. We don't generally go out and say, really feel like rehabilitating more people, let's increase the scale of the number of people that were punished. Instead, what you tend to see is that rehabilitation may be a powerful notion of what we should do to the people that we are punishing, right? And we don't tend to see, certainly in California's own recent history, the period during which California promoted rehabilitation as the primary purpose of punishment, which was roughly between 1940 and 1975, was a period where incarceration rates were actually going down in California. All right, we can come back to rehabilitation later. Most people, you ask them why they support punishments generally, or a particular punishment like the death penalty, if they do, will point to retribution, and then perhaps secondly to deterrence, somewhat of a third is incapacitation, I think partly because people don't really differentiate it or don't understand how much they already anticipate it when they think about moral retribution. But let's look at these in any event in some detail. If retribution comes to us from the world of philosophy and political theory, deterrence and also incapacitation in important ways comes to us from the world of economics and economic rationality. And of course, the 18th century is both a period where a kind of moral philosophy associated with rationality, freedom, autonomy, the things that Kant celebrated, is coming to the fore. But it's also the golden era in the sense of the birth of the economic rational mind and the idea of, you know, Adam Smith, the birth of economics as a science, etc. And deterrence is very much an economic proposition. It's essentially, under the theory of deterrence, a punishment is a price. Right? A punishment is a price. And the way to think about it is just as if, I don't know what the price of a six-pack of beer in the local liquor stores around the Brooklyn campus are these days. In my day, it sort of depended how old you looked, how far you had to walk down Telegraph to get to a liquor store that would actually sell you beer without carding you if you were under 21. But if you could find it, or if you finally got there up near the Oakland border, at least the advantage was a little bit less costly than the ones right next to campus. But I think a six-pack of Henry Weinhardt's would have run about $2.25 in those days. I think it's a little bit more now. Maybe closer to $8 or $9 for a six-pack. And of course, there's been a lot of inflation generally. But consider that if Chancellor Bergenau, you know, thought that undergraduate drinking was sapping grades or other things and really wanted to reduce the amount of beer drinking going on among the undergraduate population, certainly persuading local merchants or getting the city council or the county supervisors to put the force of law behind a doubling of beer prices would almost certainly reduce the amount of drinking. At least most economists and most economically minded people would expect it to reduce the amount of drinking. Now, would it cut the amount of drinking in half? Well, if you take economics and microeconomics, you know that it all has to do with the elasticity of drinking. How committed are you to drinking? Presumably, people like drinking, so they may pay a little bit more, but there comes a point where they're going to, if we raise the price high enough. And we've certainly seen this with cigarettes. They go pack of cigarettes, you know, with taxes, all the California taxes, I think, lag behind other states. But if you go to New York, you pay $10 or $12 for a pack of cigarettes, etc. Begins to cut down on smoking, especially for people like teenagers, where the money is even harder to get. So from that point of view, if you want to reduce the amount of beer drinking, raise the price of beer. If you want to reduce the amount of burglaries and robberies, you raise the price of burglaries and robberies, and that price is punishment. It is paid by punishment. The way contemporary mathematically inclined economists think about this is very much as essentially an equilibrium between the desire you have to engage in the illegal behavior, the good you're going to get from it, the pleasure you're going to get from it, and the anticipated pain of the price that you're going to have to pay. And of course, that is not just the difference between going to the liquor store and buying a six-pack of beer and paying that price and committing a burglary and paying that price is the uncertainty of whether you'll actually have to pay the price, right? Typically, unless you're shoplifting, right, which is itself a crime, you've got to pay for the beer and therefore experience the full impact of that doubling of the price of beer. But if you commit a burglary, you're probably hoping you're not going to have to pay the price. And so we have to factor in not just the price that will equal the desire you have for the goods that you may get from robbing or from burglarizing a house. We've also got to take into account the odds that you'll actually get away with it. And that means it's going to be, the pleasure of the crime is worth $20. If we think that there's only a one-fifth chance that we're going to get caught, it might take a $100 price to balance that out. But notice the beauty of this model if you think it works. If you really think that crime is like a product we desire to consume and punishment is the price we pay for it, then something very attractive happens. You can prevent crime by promising very severe penalties, prices, and if it works and deters people from actually committing those crimes, you'll never actually have to pay those prices. That is, neither the person won't have to experience the suffering of punishment, nor will society have to put up the cost of inflicting that punishment, which of course itself can be costly, and especially as we move into a world characterized by prison and jails rather than more symbolic or mutilating sort of physical punishments, which, while terrible, might also be less costly to society than maintaining people in prison. So that has often been the promise of deterrence. And that could be one of the things that drives punishment up over time, is that the promise of deterrence is that it won't cost you anything, so let's raise the price on our penal code of various crimes. But if it doesn't work, and over time people end up committing those crimes, and you have to hit them with that heavier punishment to fulfill the deterrent logic, you're going to end up having a lot more people in prison, potentially. So it's not so much that deterrence drives up prison populations or the amount of punishment. In theory, it shouldn't. But if it fails, if the deterrent is not a strong enough price, a high enough price to overcome maybe the optimism of the criminal that they're not going to get caught, then we can end up with a very high price to pay indeed. And that is, I think, at least part of the story of three strikes, right? So the idea is people like Gary Ewing, who have got a few crimes on their record, are going to think twice about going into that, what was it, sporting goods store to steal the golf clubs, knowing that he's going to face a 25-year to life sentence. And I'm going to come back to you in a moment and ask, why it didn't work, because obviously he committed that, I guess it was it wasn't technically robbery, it was essentially a theft, a grand theft, that because of the wobbler status of that law, it became a felony. But we'll come back to that. But notice that if the 25 years to life doesn't deter Gary Ewing, then you and I have to pay for Gary Ewing to stay in prison for those 25 years and maybe beyond. The second major utilitarian rationale for punishment is incapacitation. And this also comes essentially from an economic way of thinking, even though it also has important origins in modern scientific criminology and the premise that we can identify people whose risk of future criminality is very likely or perhaps certain. And we'll see in a moment how that can affect our calculations. But even in this table, you can see how the logic of incapacitation works and how it differs from deterrence, right? So deterrence offers the possibility of crime reduction for free, just the cost of printing up the new penal code and maybe sticking it up on the town bulletin board. Incapacitation acknowledges that there's going to be heavy cost. So There's two kinds of incapacitation. Actually, step back, there's actually two kinds of deterrence, too. I should have mentioned that. But they're not too hard to distinguish. There's specific deterrence, where I'm going to deter you by punishing you. That's what my kids experience, not severely, but usually futilely, in the form of not being able to watch a favorite show, usually retracted later under pressure, etc. But there's also general deterrence, where observing somebody punished causes everybody to think twice about committing a crime. That's what we were talking about the other day when you see the California Highway Patrol car writing the ticket and we all hit the brakes. We're experiencing general deterrence. So general incapacitation is a bit different than general deterrence. Here, the idea is we don't know exactly who commits more crimes than others. But we know that if they commit crimes, if this crime that they've committed that got them in, presented to us for punishment isn't just a fluke, if they're really going to keep committing crimes, either in the sense of professional or habitual or at least regular criminal, then we can achieve some crime reduction simply by taking them out of the community. The problem, of course, is that it's very expensive. So look at this simulation here. Let's say you've got 25 prisoners, and you know that of this 25 prisoners, each of them commits on average 5 crimes a year when they're out in the community. If you imprison them for 1 year, you prevent 125 crimes that would otherwise have happened in the community. But it's not cheap. it costs, let's say, $50,000 a year to keep each one of them in prison for that year. So it's going to, these are thousands here. It's going to cost you about $1.25 million to prevent those 125 crimes, or a nice fat $10,000 a crime. And as you can see, I mean, that looks good in the sense that it works. It looks like it works. If we really believe that these guys are going to commit five crimes next year and we have them locked up, we will have prevented that. But it's a pretty high cost per crime. Notice that Gary Ewing's crime, the four golf clubs at $399 a piece, I didn't realize golf was that expensive, but it adds up, would have, that crime totaled about $1,200. So we'd be spending about $10,000 to prevent each $1,200 crime. Now, of course, you may be saying, but what if the crime they're going to commit is rape or an armed robbery, let alone a murder? You can imagine that that price might seem much more attractive. Problem, of course, is that to our ability to predict future criminal behavior is limited, and it's best for property crimes, right? Not too many people are professional killers, right? Outside of the movies, there are hitmen, et cetera, I suppose. But most murders are not committed by professionals. Instead, they're committed by people who may use weapons and violence as part of their professional work, like drug dealers that need to be armed to fend off rivals or enforce contracts, but they don't routinely kill people as part of their job, and therefore it's hard to predict how many killings you'll prevent a year by locking them up. On the other hand, as criminologists, we feel more confident that if somebody has moved into becoming a burglar, that's how they get their money, to buy drugs or buy school books or whatever it is they need, then there's a much better chance that they're going to commit future burglaries if they're in the community. And if they're locked up, well, they can commit crimes on each other and perhaps on correctional staff. But obviously, the general public will be a bit more protected. But as you can see, the problem is, as you want to raise the amount of crimes you're preventing, you have to add on more years. So you can prevent 625 crimes by keeping them in prison for 5 years. You can prevent over 3,000 crimes by committing them in prison for 25 years. But you'll be paying around $31 million to accomplish that. And if you start adding up more than 25 prisoners, it gets very, very expensive. Now, that is, to some extent, what California does. We are a general incapacitation state, as we'll see in many respects. But the promise that has often been intriguing to criminologists but has not really had much bearing yet on policy, but is, I think, worth considering as we think about how to change California's penal patterns, is to think about what's called selective incapacitation. And so imagine that, and criminologists have long believed, that if you take a group of people, let's say all the boys born in Philadelphia in 1945, and 20 years later you go back and try to figure out how many crimes that entire population of boys committed, now putting aside that you're going to be dealing with police records that are inaccurate and many crimes won't have been detected, et cetera. If you assume that at least that there's a rough proportionality between the crimes they committed and the crimes that were known about, what studies have shown since the 60s is that there's often a small group of offenders that accounts for an outsized portion of the total crime. And the figure often given is that 5% of the offenders account for half of the crime. Now, if that's true, and there's at least some reason to believe it is, then there's a very intriguing possibility out there. If we could find offenders committing burglary or robbery who, instead of committing an average of five crimes per year, are committing an average of 62.5 crimes a year, which would be what would be necessary for 5% of them to account for half of the total crimes that I'm stipulating, you get a much more attractive incapacitation opportunity. Here, if you put five prisoners in prison for 1 year, you prevent 312 crimes for $250,000 at a cost per crime prevented of under $1,000, about $800. At that point, it could make sense to put Gary Ewing in prison for a year if you thought he was going to commit another one of those grand thefts, let alone 62.5 of them. And as you can see, you can try to expand your incapacitative effects 5 years or 25 years, increasing the number of crimes you're preventing, but staying at a relatively low cost per crime. Now, the big problem with this kind of selective incapacitation, of course, is, well, twofold. One, it involves treating people unequally. We're going to have people coming in front of the courts that have committed the same crime, and we're going to say, Hannah is a low-rate burglar, so we're just going to give her a year or maybe probation, but Tony is one of those high-rate burglars that's doing 62.5 burglars a year, so let's give her 5 years or even 25 years, and that obviously involves treating people differently. It assumes that we can predict who is a high-rate offender and who's not, based on things like their past criminal record or the shape of their skull or some other thing that we think we can come up with that is valid and sustainable, and that's been very, very hard to do. The other thing, and I want to come back to this later, the other thing it assumes, of course, and this is very much an assumption behind three strikes, is that if Coney's committing 62.5 burglaries a year this year, she's going to be committing 62.5 burglaries next year and 62.5 burglaries in 10 years and in 20 years and in 25 years. And of course, it turns out that we have a lot of evidence to suggest that's not true, that just like your batting average and any other good things in life, your crime average goes down with age, and it actually starts to go down at a relatively young age. And by the time you get to my age, unless you've got extraordinary motivation, the crime rate starts to approach zero. So if you think there is change in people, then this kind of incapacitation is problematic. Or at least we have to ask, what's the optimal moment to stop incapacitating this person? Maybe it makes sense to incapacitate Coney for the next 5 years, but figuring that once she hits the big 3-0, she's going to radically slow down on the crimes, we're going to parole her at that point. All right, I just want to give you a general sense of how we talk about these two major schools of thought on the reasons to punish, motivations to punish, if you will. And I think you can see that both of them point in ways that punishment can become built up beyond what you might think of as the moral appetite of the community for punishment on a psychological level through the promise of preventing crime. In the case of deterrence, it's through the failed promise of deterring crime. When crime isn't deterred, we end up having to punish people for a very long time. In incapacitation, at least we're honest with ourselves, we know we're going to have to pay the high costs, but we will never know if we're actually getting the gain because the people we have in prison aren't in the community running the experiment. So we don't know whether we're actually saving, preventing crimes. We can certainly hope that we are. And realistically, we're almost certainly preventing some crimes. The question is, are we preventing enough to make it worth the money? You'll notice that some crimes might be, essentially a larger labor market of people willing to commit those crimes. So if we take a high rate burglar off the street, and if there's a market for stolen goods out there, and fences is the word we use for people who buy stolen merchandise and then traffic in it, if they're putting out the word that they need more stolen goods and we've locked up both Tony and Hannah, maybe one of you will step forward to take their place because there's a market for those goods. If we can't be sure that we're actually preventing crimes, we may be shipping around who's committing them. But at least we have some reason to believe that we are.